Greetings to you and welcome to this very special flipped seminar series that is titled You Can't Plan for Crazy. Hello, I'm Tara Brabazon.
I'm Sunny Shvara.
And I'm Natalia Schmel.
And the three of us together are going to create absolute havoc. And we're going to tell you a truth, a difficult truth, about the nature of doctoral candidature and the crazy things that happen and perhaps how you can predict them and also solve them. So these extraordinary women are going to change your life today and today going forward.
Yes.
You are both amazing. This is unbelievable. So we'll start with you both. Sunny, now you decide who starts. Do you want to just share with the guys and gals what your PhD is on?
Okay, so my name is Sunny. I'm doing my PhD in cultural studies and I'm looking at the representation of African immigrants in Australian media, particularly the xenophobia and exclusion that's often applied to the large African demographic. So just wrapping it up within weeks of submission.
Within days of submission, we're thinking about 10 days. Well done, Sunny. Nat Star.
Hey, guys. So I'm working in science, which is really cool. We've got these two different fields going. It's awesome. So my thesis is going to be called The Investigations of Emergent Nanomaterials Using Electron and Ion Scattering Spectroscopies. What that means in normal English is that I get little tiny samples like this tiny little guy here, and they're little layers of what would turn into something like a solar cell. And then I throw like X-rays and UV photons and all this cool stuff at the sample and get all these electrons out of it. And then I get to find out exactly what's going on in there and whether it's actually going to work with the next layer of the cell. And therefore, we may get the next smartphone, solar cell, LED, in theory.
Awesome.
Boom.
Yeah.
Now, fantastic. Great thesis. And as Nat said, we've got the high humanities, the hard sciences, and these two get on fantastically well. And they're just both remarkable people. I don't know your answer to this question, so I'm going to just ask it. Looking back on your candidature, and both of you are near the end of it, talking to guys and gals in the mid stages or near the beginning, what was the biggest surprise that you confronted in your candidature? Nat, do you want to start us off, Dawn?
Yeah, sure. I think the biggest surprise I came into was the change. You're still a student, right? But you're actually doing normal work days. And that's a big shock. Coming from undergrad, which is all crazy, and then you get breaks, and then honours, which is even more crazy, and then you get a big break. It's not the same. So the biggest surprise for me was the fact that it's like, right, I'm still a student, but there's not those constant little updates. There's not a constant deadline for this and that and the other. It's like, okay, we're in a normal work mode, even though you're still being paid like a student. So it's a big shock. You're like, oh, right, there's no official deadline. This is a wafting next 3 years with a few little bits and pieces and milestones in the middle. And it's like, it's a surprise. It really was.
So it's that floating tendency. It's like,
yes.
What's the end point? Where is it going?
Yeah.
So I think that's really
making
powerful.
Making your own goals. You know, the milestones are there for all of us, and literature review, as you guys will probably already know. But you really need to make sure, like, you know, in undergrad and honours, it's almost like a week to week.
Yes.
You need those updates.
A timetable.
You need to make your own timetable.
Yes.
That's what it is.
I think that's absolutely right. That's a huge surprise. Now, where are you on this, Gorgeous Sun?
I think echoing on what Nat just said, it's just that freedom is a word for it. I thought PhDs would still have group seminars, and now some faculties or schools still have group seminars, but often, like when I started mine, I was just in an office by myself. And I was like this for 6 months, and I just thought, well, if no one's checking what I'm doing, how do I make sure it's done? Am I reading enough? How much is enough? All these questions start emerging as you're reading the literature.
Yes.
But I soon found that you can, you know, confide in your supervisors, as well as reading other people's proposal, attending other people's confirmation of candidatures. You start to know what's required, how much you must do, and what's, you know, standard. And it's okay to have breaks, which is the hardest thing, I think.
And I think, again, Sunny's point's a great one too, because of course you came from a lab environment where there are lots of people around. Sunny, not many people around, but what is the standard? How much reading is enough?
Absolutely.
How many experiments are enough? Those sort of variables are really difficult to determine, I think. Really, really clever. Now, this is the hard question about the disappointments. So, you know, we all want you to have a fantastic time in your PhD, but looking back on it now near the end, what was or what were the greatest disappointments that you confronted? Sunny, do you want to have a go?
I would say, stemming from that aloneness in the office or in the lab, is also taking control because the previous degrees, you sort of are shepherded. You've got assignments, you've got your due dates, you get your feedback. However, with a PhD, it depends on your supervision technique and your team. Some of them prefer just email once a month, and that works for them. But I needed to report to someone who would tell me if I was on the right track or wrong track. And my disappointment was when I went to those people who were supposed to be looking after me and, you know, nurturing this project that I was doing, and they were nowhere to be found. Or when they were found, instead of saying it was out of their depth, they just encouraged me to just keep going, even though it was a dead end.
So I think, you know, Sunny changed supervisors during her candidature, changed really the whole set of supervisors, and you can see the challenge and the disappointment. And the trouble is, you can see that she embedded that disappointment in herself. It's like, it must be me. Whereas actually, the supervisors and that team did not suit you.
Yes.
It wasn't about you, but you took it personally.
It is. And also being an international student, a paying international student, it's hard because that time is supposed to be going towards something. There's no second chance. You can't, you know, take an extra 6 months if you're paying, as some of you might know. And it was very stressful, not just academically, but personally as well.
Really well said. Now, Nat, I don't know how you relate to that, or in terms of the disappointment of your candidature. It's always hard to go to the negative stuff, but looking back, what was the disappointment for you?
Similar to Sunny in some respects, with the whole knowing who to turn to, when supervisors, you know, are correct, or whether if you need to actually go be more assertive,
yes.
you know, because that's part of the thing is that this is your PhD, remember that. And the whole point of it being your PhD is by the end of it, you should know more than just about anybody else on this. So there's times where you'll be right and they'll be wrong, which is really weird, but it's kind of cool.
Correct.
But
Sunny, of course, knows that. Sunny knows
that. Hindsight's great.
Yeah.
Her supervisors are wrong a lot.
But yeah.
Woo!
Woo!
Personal joke there.
Yeah.
Look, the disappointing thing, I think, for me, big time, has been time management and time loss. So I found, so in science, I don't know so much how much you work in humanities like this, but you often end up in a collaborative effort, whether it be internationally, interstate, just between unis. Often in collaborations, the ones that I was involved in anyway, is you find that the maybe the postdocs or other professors, whoever else in the collaboration, they're of course there for the industry or for the grant or for whatever. Fine, fair enough, as it should be. But we have to be here for our PhDs, and they don't. That's not their priority. Again, that's fair, but if you're not careful with your time management and very assertive and to the point of almost being selfish, you can lose so much time on, and this happened to me, little side projects where, oh, can you measure these samples, or could we do this, or even working in the laboratory. So I did a lot of lab management, and I lost an enormous amount of time. Amazing machine to do maintenance on, don't get me wrong, but big disappointment, lots of time was lost. You know, lots of time was lost. I'm overdue on my candidature, very distressed about it. Huge pressure, but, you know, that's been hard. And then, of course, the other thing disappointment-wise, this massive sense of disillusionment that comes through with the candidature, because you're thinking, well, what am I doing? And I don't know about all of you guys doing your PhDs, but I know quite a lot of people in their PhDs sort of go partway through and start thinking, wait, why am I doing this again? I'm not getting paid much, and I don't know if I'll get a job, and I could have already got one when I finished honours. Like, and it's a big thing.
It
if
is.
This isn't here, certainly for me and a lot of people I know, if this isn't feeling it, then you can't, well, you can keep pushing on, but you end up just in yourself sinking into a little bit of a hole. And instead of loving what you're doing, which is why we did it in the first place, you just sink and feel sad, you know, or feel nothing.
Just tired. And you see people compress in on themselves, Nat, too, in the final year where it becomes this
big
terrible
time.
I say to our first-year students, do not be a guest star in your own PhD. You are the star of your PhD. And be selfish. You have a right to be selfish. Particularly, I think, women in the program, but a lot of men as well. They will always give and enable and support others. And it is your PhD. It's your name on that certificate.
Yes.
You've earned it. So.
Yes.
Really powerful, really upsetting too. Are you feeling, Nat, that you're through that now? Have you reconnected with your passion, yourself, and seeing the end now?
Yeah, I am. It's so good. Partway through a paper at the moment.
Woo!
It's really cool. But yeah, I graduation December. This is go.
Goal in mind, yeah.
Doing it for my nan, doing it for my family, doing it for myself. And I've found it again. I mean, I love science so much. That's my thing. And instead of just trudging through, I'm back at like, no, come on.
This matters.
That light at the end of the tunnel is not actually a train.
No,
there's sun out there.
Yes.
And I think that's really powerful. There is a light at the end of the tunnel, and it's not coming at you like a train. It's taking you somewhere else.
Yes.
Really powerful.
Yeah, yeah.
Next, again, hard question, and then I'll let you keep going on this one if you can.
Sure.
What would you do differently if you had your time over again? Because we've got people, particularly about mid-candidature, looking at you going, I want to be where you are.
Sure.
What would you have changed?
First thing I would have done, I would have picked a different project to start with.
Oh,
so,
well,
no. I didn't change principal supervisor, but I changed project partway through.
Wow.
Yeah, now that was a toughie. Not fun. Any of you out there that have to do it, great, don't do it.
That's also
no,
characteristic of people that take a long time. Too.
Yes, it is. And so I had to change project. Now, the project I chose because it was there. My supervisor needed someone to start working with it. I wanted to work with him. I just thought, sure, okay, let's get going on this. And I shouldn't have, because it wasn't a passion of mine. Mm-hmm. So it was a microfluidics is the name of it. Mm-hmm. It's making these specific devices for forensic applications. Yeah. Very important stuff, but it wasn't me. I'm a green energy girl. So the passion wasn't there. That makes a big difference.
Yes.
If the passion isn't there with the project, that makes a problem, right?
It does.
Then also that particular project didn't go well either. We were having issues within the first few months of experiments going, this isn't attaching, this isn't doing what it should be. And there's all these, this is where hindsight's great, all these red flags. And when you're wearing rose-colored glasses, the red flags just look like flags. So I'm just going along past these red flags going, it's not working, it will. And it didn't. So then I changed projects. So I'd do that differently. I'd go with the damn solar cells from the start because I know that this is going to help keep me going, you know?
Yeah, and but again, how powerful is it that you weren't intrinsically motivated, but you kept going to finish? I mean, that's powerful.
Of course.
And that's why you will end up working in the most brilliant places on this planet, because even when a lot of other things aren't going well, you've kept going, you've prevailed, you've been resilient, and you've succeeded. And that's astounding, Nat.
Yeah, thank you.
All credit to you. I don't know what this one's going to say. What would you have done differently, Sunny?
What would have I done differently? I would have had more confidence in myself in just going
Good
for
call.
Publications, going for literature that I thought was key, but that I was dissuaded with, obviously not with this fabulous supervisor, and just nurturing myself as a student rather than shying away and just expecting greatness to come. Because the thing is, when you have supervision meetings, they can go either one of two ways. Now, they go brilliantly. We match, we wear florals, and we discuss high theory. Other way, it can just be, no, this is wrong, no, this is wrong, go back and do it again. Now, that's, to me, that's not how a candidature should be.
No.
You should feel able to express what you want to do, and if there are theoretical discussions or disagreements, that's fine, let's just stick to that. But other people, like my previous supervisors, tended to dwell on the negative.
Yeah.
So the theory isn't right, maybe you need to go for English lessons, maybe... maybe a PhD isn't right for you. And these are things that happen, and you need to be confident enough to say, well, thank you very much, but we're going to part ways because this is not right for me. So I think that's what I would have done differently. Just have the confidence in myself as a researcher as well as a student, just to feel like I need support and not just sink.
And can I just say how unbelievable that is? Because this is the most brilliant woman. As you can see, these two women are stellar. They represent this university brilliantly. You are both amazing.
Mm.
But the idea, Sunny, and Nat, you and I have talked about this too, that you ever felt underconfident, that you ever felt not worthy, that's stunning to me.
Mm.
Is there any way you could say to the guys and girls out there how you can stop that in yourself, the self-doubt?
I think you need to be confident when you walk into a PhD. It's different from anything you would have ever done. It's an isolating experience, don't get me wrong. You're in your head a lot of the time. And when you start to introduce doubt to mental work, I'm sure you've done it in many tasks, it just messes you up.
Yeah.
So you need to walk in having an idea of what you want to do, knowing the researchers in your field, which plays into picking the good supervisors,
yeah.
and just having confidence to voice your concerns should you feel like you're not being listened to, or the time management isn't working properly, or meetings aren't going to plan. And that was my fault. I did not have the confidence to just say, let's just park it here, thank you very much.
Did you ever have a confidence issue?
Oh, massive. Absolutely wow. massive confidence issues. Like I walked into the PhD thinking, wow, what an experience, this is going to be great. And then things start going badly, time management, all of the, there's this myriad of things that can start happening with a PhD. Mm-hmm. And the confidence, it seems to be a very natural human response mm-hmm. that we take it into ourselves and start the self-doubt and self-blame.
Yes. Yeah.
My confidence was appalling for so much of my PhD, you know, and
oh,
I think,
Matt.
And I look back now, and I think one of the big things I could say for anyone doing a PhD is, guys, you're doing a friggin' PhD. Do you know
yes.
how amazing that is? Like, seriously, that is a huge thing. That's like this stuff.
Yes.
The fact you're even trying it is so amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I've thought that myself because I was like, oh, no, I suck. Oh, I'm not good. I'm a crap scientist. Blah, 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 blah. That sample fell on the floor. That's it. I'm out. You know, like, well, it happens.
It's
real. The stress
okay.
is real.
I know.
But not, you're doing your PhD. You know how people like go, oh, you're going to be a doctor, da-da. There's a reason they do that. It's because it's bloody hard. So if you're not going well, that's kind of part of the course.
Yes.
But like, so much of a PhD is actually about learning about who you are.
Yes.
It's not about the damn thesis and the topic. Having a PhD, I think one day, you know, as an employer, if I saw someone has a PhD, I'd be like, oh, they've been there.
They've been there.
They've been to the dark place and
they've
returned.
Been through the dark side. You know,
yeah.
it's a
resilience.
Thing. It is.
Yes.
It's a character building exercise more than it is about any specific, you know, whether it be a cultural study, a scientific study. It's actually learning about yourself, what your weaknesses are and what your strengths are.
And
so when you're long, and
yes.
if you can't hit a point of low confidence, if your PhD is easy the whole way, you're not going to learn much about yourself.
It's also not research. Research by
yes.
its nature. We can't predict what's going to happen.
No,
of course. If we could, it's not an original contribution to knowledge.
Amen.
Yeah.
You're
so true.
Resilience. How resilient and fabulous are
yeah.
these wonderful women. You've already mentioned time in your last answer to me there.
Yes.
How do you manage time? Time management is often the big issue that PhD students talk about. I often think, I wonder if it is time management or if it's task management.
Mm.
But can you tell me about your relationship with time and how you've handled those unexpected eventualities?
Well, my relationship with time, I'm actually a surface scientist, Tara. I'm not the type of physicist that goes looking at time because it's a really weird concept.
they are.
Sorry.
I've met those
I'll get away from the smart aleck response. Look, I find time management or task management, whether it be in a PhD or any other aspect, it's life.
Yeah.
You have a set of things you need to do, whatever that is.
Yeah.
I find I'm a list girl. I
yes.
love my lists. I'm one of those people that actually write a thing on the
oh,
list
yes.
just so I can tick it because I've already done that.
Oh,
today.
You're a ticker, not a crosser? Do you cross it out or you tick it? You tick it.
Mood depends.
Mood depends.
Yeah, yeah. And I like my coloured pencils and texts
oh, yes.
and colours. But look, list, prioritisation,
yes.
it's the exact same thing in a PhD as anything else. It's
yeah.
like, right, what do I have to get through today? And then
yes.
once you know that, go right, numero uno, boom.
Next one, done. So your planning and your structuring of time
mm-hmm.
and task is what made a difference and kept you on course to finish.
Yes, yes.
Right, are you a colour-coded list girl?
I do write lists, many lists. I can give a speech on list writing. But in terms of PhD, yes, it's good to know what you're doing. I think after the first year, mid-candidate point, you should have, you know, an idea of how you're going to write, if you're in the humanities, how you're going to write or conduct your field work.
Yes.
Or writing and conducting field work at the same time. Or in a lab, obviously, things work differently because you have to wait for experiments. But definitely make a list. It can be fooling knowing that you've got 3 years to do something and you're full time and you're like, oh, I won't go
yeah.
in this week because, you know, Bruce Springsteen is touring Australia and I'm going to follow him around. Or, you know, things. But people with families also, kids get sick, people in jobs doing this part-time, you know, workloads increase,
mm-hmm.
personal relationships. Those are things you don't plan for when you're doing your timeline for a PhD. So,
no.
you know, when I had my setbacks, I hadn't enrolled in a PhD thinking, oh, 6 months in, I'm going to change topic. And then 6 months later, I'm going to have a breakdown with my supervisors and have to change supervisors.
And states and universities.
Yes, and states and universities. Those were things I hadn't planned for. So you have to use each day to its best because, you know, things happen. I was in hospital twice during my candidature. And those are times I hadn't planned for, but you just have to work your best and account for those days that might happen, but don't plan, oh, if I do a month's work, that means I can rest for two. It doesn't work like that, because life doesn't work like that. In those 2 months, you know, you could be in hospital or, you know, your children could be sick, but don't say you'll do a month's work, then, you know, take time off. Just work as much as you can, as often as you can.
Stick to one cat video, don't watch the whole playlist.
Yeah, all the goat ones, I'm a big fan
of them. Yes. Goat, don't get me started on goats. My goat.
Oh, love goats.
Go to Haunters.
Love your goat.
He's
love
my baby.
Love goats, big fan of goats. Mm. I am going to push and press Sunny a little bit though, and this is something I've always wanted to ask you, because just to clarify, she's being very kind and compassionate, as she always is, but Sunny, international student, arrived in regional Australia, so in a regional university, full fee paying, so not any form of even like fee offset, full fees, had to then change supervisors, change universities, change states, and has finished in 2 years, 11 months. Now.
That's mental.
Everybody who is, I mean, I'm in awe of you.
Yeah.
I'm in awe of you.
Yeah.
Now. What has, and you know, this is a hard question, I've never asked you this, but what has kept you going, Sunny? How have you managed things that a lot of people would have left at each stage? You know, your family has sacrificed so much for you to be here. Your wonderful dad, who won't get upset, but your family has sacrificed so much, and you know, these appalling things have happened that people would leave the program, Sunny, and you've handled all of them. How have you done that?
You just have to have the end goal in mind, twofold. Firstly, I didn't have an option because I was fee paying, so it had to be done. I mean, the $25,000 a year is no joke, right? After that, after I met Tara and Steve, my supervisors, and after everything they've done for me in my candidature, I had to make them proud. There was, I had to catch up. I had to do these things, but it was out of joy. After, you know, the unfortunate start, it was out of joy and knowing that people believed in me and that I could actually, because the end goal is for me is to stay in academia.
Yeah.
So if I'm going to stay in academia, then I have, you know, to work like an academic and do the best I can. Of course, there are bumps in the way, but, you know, you have to have that end goal in mind. There's no, for me, there's no turning back.
Mm-hmm.
This is it. This is my one shot. You know, my family has invested in this. I've invested in this. Other people have invested in this. So there's no quitting. And that's just how I've lived by.
It sounds like determination to me.
I mean, that's unbelievable, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, both of you are just so damn inspiring. That is stunning to me. And therefore, last question. Haven't they been amazing? Amazing. Last question for all the students out there, Flinders and beyond. What advice would you offer to students thinking about the doctoral enrolment, being in the middle of a doctoral enrolment, and perhaps they're having a bad day, a bad week, a bad month, or a bad year? What would you advise them? Nat, start.
Okay, a couple of things. I think, firstly, seek help. Okay, that first and foremost, like a bad day is one thing, we're all going to get that sometimes, but even 1 week makes a difference, right? A whole bad week in science is, as an example, you know, you may have a set of samples go wrong. Okay, you've done everything you can, it doesn't work. But if that's affecting you and affecting your ability to work, then whether it be, you know, talk to one of your mates or a family thing, talk to your supervisor. You know, if it's an issue that you're having with your supervisor, I know at Flinders, I'm sure this would be the same for other unis, go see a counsellor. There are specific counsellors for this stuff. Like, do not sit there and fester in your lack of self-confidence, your stress, any of that. Get help.
Self-blame.
Any of it, you know? It's like, no, you are good enough, so go get help. Like, you don't need to sit there and go, I should be able to do this by myself. You're already doing it by yourself. It's your PhD. So that's thing number one. You know, get help. As soon as you feel like you're actually, even the head starts to go underwater, go get some help from someone.
Call it early.
Call it early. And I think the other one I'd say is, manage the thesis angel and devil. they're a thing, trust me. They hang out on your shoulders and they put a lot of knots in them, so get a massage every now and again. But learn to listen to them, because there is actually a balance with that, the light and the dark. There are times where the thesis angel's saying, keep going, mm. Well, you've already done 12 hours that day. Stop, yes. You know, and it is a balance, you know. Mr. Goat videos is your little devils, like, oh, we can take a break. It's like, well, actually, if you've only done half an hour, it's a balance thing, right? So keep a balance, learn to knock off, make sure you get the time you need for your own hobbies. I ditched a lot of my hobbies during my PhD. I did. And that's not healthy.
And you regret that.
Of course I do. And it helped. It was what helped me lose confidence in myself, because all those things that make me feel good, I wasn't doing. I was too busy going, oh, I better keep going with this, you know? And lastly, I think, watch the, I guess this is part of the thesis angel and devil again, is learn to zoom in versus zoom out, the perspective stuff, you know? Occasionally you're going to be going, oh, what am I doing this for? You're being so big picture, it's actually going to distract you from, well, I've actually just got to do this today, you know? But if you're always zoned into the, I've got to do this, I've got to do now, and then that can get depressing as well. Mm-hmm. Why am I doing it? Go back to big picture. Where do you see yourself in 10 years? So it's that zoom in, zoom out stuff.
Wow.
That's what I'd say. Yeah. Get help, watch your perspective and let it change, and watch the thesis angel and devil.
Legend.
Yeah.
Legend.
Well, what would I add to that?
I've been thinking about this a lot. This means a lot to me that I can hope, if this can help some of you guys out there, that would be so cool, right? So this has had me very excited.
And you're going to help and change thousands of people now.
We're cool.
Right, Mrs. What would you say, and I mean, this is powerful, you might want to direct it to international students, to women, to people isolated in an office. What would you say to them in terms of advice going forward?
Particularly in the humanities, we've got the luxury of not just having books. Like in cultural studies, I'm fortunate enough to have a theorist who liked to give lectures. So learning can occur when you're watching a lecture by this person. Learning can occur if you're watching something that relates to your field. Take, for instance, cultural studies of marginalized groups. I can watch a documentary about immigration into Australia. Mm-hmm. I can watch a historical film about the same themes.
Yes.
And that's when your brain starts working subconsciously, that when you sit down to write, you know, it pops something, and then you write through the problem. That's what Tara always says, write through the problem. So when you're feeling stuck, don't sit in an office in front of a computer with a blank page. That helps no one.
Wow.
No one ever. Do something to help yourself. Walk around uni. If you're studying people, walk around campus. Look at people.
Yeah.
We have a fabulous campus here at Flinders.
We do.
We've got ocean views. We've got, you know, it's amazing.
Yeah.
Walk around. Look at people. That's the luxury of being in humanities and social sciences. Even if you're in the hard sciences, just take a break. Come back to it.
Yeah, so true.
If something is too complex, you don't understand, read a textbook.
Change modes.
Yes. I used to be embarrassed of not reading journal-only material. And then I discovered it was getting me nowhere, because sometimes journal articles are so dense, you can't penetrate them when your mind is foggy.
Yeah.
Watch a documentary, watch a lecture from a different uni, attend a talk in your session.
Yeah.
These are all still doing work. Just because you're not physically typing does not mean you're not learning. As long as you have got an outcome and it's building a foundation to that outcome, any learning is good learning.
I think that's really, really powerful. And that's great. If one mode is not working for you, change modes for a day, for a week, and come back. I think that's fantastic.
Mm.
To Nat and to Sunny, it has been a pleasure and a profound inspiration for me to hear and see you both. You embody the best of what Australian higher education can be. You are our next generation of profound scholars. And this future in this country is incredibly safe with you both.
Thank you.
Are stellar human beings. Thank you for your time.
Thank you so much.
I look forward to seeing some of you guys.
To women.
Thank you for giving us the opportunity.
Yeah, thank you. This has been wonderful. This is fun. Let's do this
every week.